William F. Buckley, Jr., speaking in the Landon Lecture Series on public issues here at K-State. Buckley is a columnist, an author, an editor, and a lecturer, often controversial. He describes himself as a conservative radical. He's been a force in forming public opinion in this nation since the mid-1950s, when he founded the National Review magazine. Since that time, he's greatly expanded his audience through a syndicated newspaper column that is now read three times a week in some 300 newspapers across the country, and through his weekly radio and television program, Firing Line, which is heard over the Public Broadcasting Service on television and National Public Radio on radio. The topic for his lecture this morning is the assault on the free market. We have a capacity crowd of some 1,800 people in KSU Auditorium. In fact, they're jammed in standing room only positions along the doors, as well as having all of the seats full. As you can hear from the applause, the dignitaries are on stage, and for the formal introductions, we switch now to the stage and Kansas State University President, Dr. James A. McCain.
Gee, seldom have I received such an ovation from an audience auditorium. I'm delighted to have this opportunity to greet all of you here in the Kansas State University Auditorium for this first in the series of Alfred M. Landon lectures on public issues to have been scheduled for the current academic year. With equal enthusiasm, I greet and welcome the thousands of people that will see this program on television and listen to it on the radio. This is the 25th in the series of Landon lectures initiated 6 years ago, which has brought to our campus many of the most distinguished persons in our nation and the world. At the outset of today's convocation, I should like to introduce to you the persons seated on the platform along with our distinguished speaker. And I will start on my left by introducing, first of all, the president of our student body and one of the ablest student leaders I have ever been associated with here at Kansas State, Joe Knopp. Next, I'd like to have you meet one of our outstanding downtown community leaders, Mr. Robert Wilson, who is chairman of the patrons of the Landon Lecture Series and a very strong and effective supporter of our university, Bob Wilson. It's always a pleasure on these occasions to have members of the Board of Regents as our special guests. They do a yeoman service in behalf of our university, and much of what they do is not known about or not recognized, so we welcome opportunities to express publicly our gratitude to our regents. The next person I'll introduce to you is the Executive Office of the Board of Regents, who holds 2 degrees from Kansas State University, Mr. Max Bickford. On my far right, we have the chairman of the Student Faculty Convocations Committee and the coordinator for the Landon Lecture Program, the Director of International Activities at K-State, and the Professor of Political Science. Will you recognize Professor Joe Hyder? And then last, but by no means least, the latest appointee to the Board of Regents of the State of Kansas, the one woman member of the Board of Regents, who is also a graduate of Kansas State University, Mrs. Prudence Hutton of Newton, Kansas. Mrs. Hutton. Of course, the purpose of the Landon Lecture Series, as those of you know who have kept informed from its very origin, is to recognize and pay suitable tribute to the most distinguished citizen of our state, a former governor of Kansas, the nominee for the presidency of the Republican Party in 1936, a man who, as an elder statesman, issues periodic pronouncements which are listened to with great respect and which have considerable influence about the affairs of the day, a great man that we are proud to claim as the favorite adopted son of Kansas State University. Will you recognize Governor Alf Landon? Alf, I hope you got the general idea that they like you. Our speaker, of course, needs no introduction. That's a cliche, of course, about anyone as prominent as he is, but a man who draws what is without a doubt the largest audience that has ever been brought into our relatively new auditorium really doesn't need any introduction. But some facts about him you might find of unusual interest. He was educated in schools in England, France, and Mexico, as well as the United States, and received his Bachelor of Arts degree with honors in political science, economics, and history at Yale University in 1950, and shortly thereafter published the book which was his first burst into fame, God and Man, at Yale. He founded a biweekly publication, the National Review, in 1955, which has become one of the most eloquent advocates of his points of view politically. He began a weekly syndicated column on the right in 1962, and since 1964 it's appeared three times a week and is now syndicated in over 300 newspapers. He ran for mayor of New York in 1965 on the Conservative Party ticket and didn't do quite as well as his brother did when he ran for the United States Senate. He began hosting a weekly television show, Firing Line, in 1965, which is now being broadcast over the Public Broadcast Services network of 207 stations. It's broadcast, for example, regularly on our own K-State radio station, KSAC, and it's telecast over the Washburn University television station, Channel 11, in Topeka every Sunday evening. In recent years, he has covered national political conventions for television, has appeared in a number of television debates, and has served as a presidential appointee to the Advisory Commission of the United States Information Agency. He's won innumerable awards and has been the recipient of innumerable honorary degrees from distinguished colleges and universities, has published several books since God and Man in Yale was first published. His hobbies include skiing, sailing, and music. He was appointed last September by the President as an official United States delegate to the 28th Assembly of the United Nations. I will present him to you as either the most famous or the notorious, depending on your point of view, speaker for the conservative point of view here in the United States. Certainly one of the best informed of the leaders of our country. I am delighted that we can have him as a guest on our campus today. It's an honor to give to you at this time Mr. William Buckley.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Mr. President, Governor Landon. I'm very happy to be here. Extremely flattered by your kindnesses. Dismayed at the prospect that they might not be repeated in our hands. I'm delighted to be in the company of Governor Landon. I always gravitate towards lost causes. I hope his I hope his contemporary popularity, as witnessed by the ovation he has just finished receiving, doesn't egg him on in that liberal direction I've been spotting in the last few years. Governor Landon was explaining to me why he lost a few minutes ago. And I was especially happy to hear it from him, who is certainly an authority on the subject. So, I confess not to have been so surprised. Nothing, in fact, has surprised me about elections ever since I spotted a small item in the New York Times the day after the defeat of Barry Goldwater. It had to do with a 72-year-old woman in New Hampshire who had voted Democratic for the first time in her life. She was questioned by her neighbors to why she had done that. And she replied that if Goldwater won, he was going to take away her TV. Her neighbor explained, no, it's TVA he's talking about, not TV. And she said, well, that was very reassuring, but she wasn't going to take any chances. It is true, Mr. President, that I have been attending the United Nations sessions, having been appointed there by Mr. Nixon. It is, in fact, the second appointment I've had. As you mentioned, that there was the one at at USIA. When you receive these appointments, as no doubt most of you will in due course, the ceremony the ceremony is rather interesting because you receive a scroll, and on that scroll there is the usual business, but there are four holes, one for your name, one for the office to which you have been appointed. The third is for the length of your term. And the fourth is introduced by the stock phrases "in recognition of." And in my hole appeared the words "his intelligence and integrity." Well, I was delighted that President Nixon knew about my intelligence and integrity. But in due course, I started wondering what was the inventory of adjectives from which those two had been selected. The lawyers have a phrase, inclusio unius, exclusio alterius. That is to say, by naming one thing, you draw attention to that which you do not name. A few months later, I was in Saigon at the office of Mr. Bunker, who suddenly called up, and I saw his scroll hanging on the wall. I rushed over to see what appeared in his blank space. I said, in recognition of his intelligence, integrity, and prudence. I'm learning a lot about prudence at the United Nations and certainly a great deal about docility. My introduction to it was traumatic. I was taken the very first day to witness a miniature debate at the offices of the United States Mission between our ambassador, Mr. John Scali, and their ambassador, Mr. Malik. There were four of them at the opposite sides of a table, just those eight people, exchanging the usual threats, insults, intimidations, after the formal session of which they were affable diplomats. And Mr. Scali said, Mr. Ambassador, I'd like you to meet William F. Buckley, Jr. And Mr. Malik turned to me and said, oh, yes, he said, I know all about you, but let me tell you something. I don't agree with you about everything. I felt then that I was a monstrous failure in the art of communication. No doubt, many of you will turn during the question period to the events of the last week or 10 days, and I will attempt to answer the questions as best as I can. Meanwhile, I thought to accost a more generic theme, the assault on the free marketplace. I regret that some of my reflections are melancholy. It hardly seems a way to repay your hospitality. But at least I promise not to do to you what Senator Humphrey did to Premier Khrushchev. Some of you may remember that when, in 1959, an AP reporter approached Senator Goldwater feverishly and said that the report had just come in over the wire, and did he ever have any comments on it, that his colleague Hubert Humphrey had spent 9 hours in continuous conversation with Premier Khrushchev. Goldwater replied that this surely was the nearest America had ever come to massive retaliation. A few weeks ago, I listened attentively to Professor John Kenneth Galbraith and Professor Jean-Francois Revel discussing the virtues and vices of America, mostly of the latter. Mr. Revel, some of you will recall, is the French philosopher who 2 or 3 years ago wrote a book tantalizingly called A Future Without Marx or Jesus. Parenthetically, I can understand A Future Without Marx, but it has always seemed to me that if our future is to be without a Jesus, the decision will probably be his, not ours. And that, in any event, Jesus is not bound by the deliberations even of best-selling French philosophers. Not that he should disdain them. Jesus desires a good press even in France, though to be sure he is mostly ignored by the press. I have no doubt that the great religious revival in America will occur only after Jack Anderson reveals that, in fact, on the third day, Christ arose. Mr. Revel joined Mr. Galbraith in deploying economic assumptions in America, assumptions that would become the theme in due course, or had become the theme of George McGovern's campaign a year earlier. But Mr. Revel said that there is in America, quote, an increasing rejection of a society motivated by profit, dominated exclusively by economic considerations, ruled by the spirit of competition, and subjected to the mutual aggressiveness of its members. This passage he concluded by saying that beneath every revolutionary idea, we find the conviction that man has become the tool of his tools, and that he must once more become an end and a value in himself. Concerning that passage, a few observations. One, I do not know of any society that is dominated exclusively by economic considerations. I think that what we have been seeing, rather, is the continuing disposition of many people to ascribe an economic motivation to every human transaction. It was, after all, only 2 years ago that an organization of militant ladies who called themselves Another Mother for Peace bombarded the Congress of the United States with 400,000 signatures of Americans who protested the Vietnam War, after having been advised by that committee that the war was actually being fought on behalf of the oil interests of America. And indeed, it transpired that a report had been circulating to the effect that U.S. oil companies were poised to take 400 million barrels of oil per day out of the Indo-Chinese shelf beginning on the week that South Vietnam won its victory. A congressional committee discovered after patient investigations that, A, 400 million barrels of oil per day is indisputably a lot of oil. In fact, it is 10 times as much oil as is taken daily out of the rest of the entire world combined. That, B, the United States owned no concessions off Indochina, and, C, no oil had been discovered off Indochina. But those clerical corrections and others like them did not significantly diminish the ranks of the true believers who continue to contend that the principal motive of the United States in Southeast Asia was economic. Once we have fought our way through the lines of the orthodox economic determinists, whose arguments are soft and sloppily deployed, we come upon a superior force which is ethical in nature. Suggested by Mr. Revell's contention that our society, inasmuch as it is motivated by profit, is therefore subjected to the mutual aggressiveness of its members. It is, as you know, widely suggested that it has been a reaction against such aggressiveness that caused the great upheavals of the past years. Yet during the most vociferous years, in the late 60s and early 70s, there were student riots not only in Chicago and Berkeley, but in Paris and Madrid, Tokyo and Berlin, New Delhi and Mexico, not to say the whole of China. On and on they came, their geographical coordinates unpredictable, such that the taxonomists finally threw up their instruments in dismay after attempting unsuccessfully to correlate the dissatisfactions with private enterprise, or the Vietnam War, or racism, of which, if you throw in a clitoral orgasm, constitute, I suppose, a comprehensive list of major student concerns of that decade. They were social convulsions, to be sure, and their reality we cannot dispute. But they did not so greatly surprise observers whose Richter scales are less easily disturbed than those of the New York Times. Professors Christopher Dawson and David Reisman, a historian and a sociologist, to name only two of the scholars who come readily to mind, have long been aware, among so many others, of the phenomenon of what they called anomie, the great fault in human nature, which, like the geophysical faults that cause elemental disturbances beneath the surface of the earth, caused deracinated man to shudder with fright and loneliness and despair. But even granting the general complaint, it is, I think, instructive to ask why so often, as in the work of Professors Revell and Galbraith, the concrete thrust of their criticism is lodged against the free marketplace, against the institution of private property. What is it they prefer? Mr. Galbraith, whose most recent book was reviewed in New York only a week ago, proclaims himself now, I think belatedly, a socialist. And no doubt in that book and in the one before in which he spoke so enthusiastically about the People's Republic of China, he did so in part because he found Mao's China liberated from the afflictions of the free marketplace. Mind you, in the book, he acknowledged the authoritarian character of the regime, but quickly he puts a gloss on it. Dissidents, he writes, that is how he describes Chinese who want to read books they want to read, or who want to change their jobs or leave the country or practice their religion. Dissidents are brought firmly into line in China, but one suspects with great politeness. It is, he says, a firmly authoritarian society in which those in charge smile and say please. In Mr. Galbraith's book, Mao Zedong emerges as a sort of rector of Justin, but focus now narrowly on the economic arrangements in China. Authoritarianism can indeed, as we all know, work marvels. As Mr. Galbraith, ever the wistful former head of the Office of Price Administration, discerns. Listen. In any other country, Mr. Galbraith observes, the difference between urban and rural incomes would set in motion a large movement of people to the cities, and in China it once did. This is not now happening. The reason, he says, is straightforward. The Chinese are assigned jobs and remain where they are assigned. And then Professor Galbraith, perhaps the leading cultural critic in America of the free market, gets quite specific. After all, he was in China as an economist. Indeed, as president of the American Economics Association. And he was traveling there in the company of two predecessor presidents of the same association. And so in one chapter, the great economist strips for action and becomes all professional, like Charles Darwin whipping out his magnifying glass. While the higher authority decides what prices ought to be, writes Professor Galbraith, about the workings of the municipal market in Peking, such authority is intelligently susceptible to suggestions as to when abundance requires reduction and scarcity an increase. The keeper of the apple stall whom I consulted informally told me that, of course, apples were reduced in price as the autumn advanced and the supply became more abundant. Leaping lizards. Reduce the price of apples when they are abundant, increase the price of apples when they are scarce. Score one more thought for Chairman Mao. Now, granted, higher authority, that is the term they use in China, higher authority isn't always finely tuned to the vagaries of human nature, to such things as harvest yields and fluctuating human tastes and reallocations of still higher authority. And when the highest authority himself makes the wrong decisions, well, let's let Professor Tobin tell it, the traveling companion of Mr. Galbraith and economic advisor to the late George McGovern. Professor Tobin observes, Mr. Galbraith quotes, observes that there are no dogs or cats in China. The reason, he says, is presumably economic. If food has been scarce and rationed, affection for a participating pet must diminish. This seems especially probable, he concludes, if the pet is itself edible. Let me tell you something, Professor Galbraith and Professors Revelle and Tobin and anyone else who wants to hear it. The reason for eating one's pet dog isn't economic. It is biological. It is the assertion of biological need over economic choice. And it is to such biological compulsions that the Chinese were recently driven by higher authority. And when higher authority, assuming the mantle of the marketplace, makes miscalculations so serious that not even great politeness serves to bring dissidents into line, why then the muzzle of a gun becomes the only relevant article of the marketplace. And the supply of guns in China never fluctuates with the seasons. By that time, Mr. Galbraith has finished his brief passage in China and is back now in America, preaching the anachronism of the free marketplace and the price system, and dealing with his own dissenters, not always with great politeness. Perhaps Samuel Johnson went too far when he remarked 200 years ago that man is seldom so innocently engaged as when in pursuit of profit. But I confess to being more shaken by the complimentary suggestion that the free marketplace introduces mutual aggressiveness. Surely that, not Johnson's, is the climactic effrontery. But the notion that it is an act of aggression to lay before the individual a choice, whether of canned soups or of economic textbooks or of newspapers, by that token, it becomes an act of aggression to write another song or paint a canvas or set down a verse or write a judicial opinion on the grounds that by doing so we muscle into territory already spoken for. The ethical case against the free marketplace retreats, but leaves us facing the entrenched positions of the critics of our society whose complaint is against the dehumanization of Western economic arrangements as summarized by Professor Revelle's conclusion that over here, man has become the tool of his tools, ceasing to be an end and a value in himself, and reminding us that the search of our young revolutionists is for the restoration of the individual as once again an end and a value in himself. I myself view the mechanization of the individual as the principal commitment of American secularism, of men who have lost hold of the metaphysical arguments, leaving them with a philosophy of positivism, to which they now conjoin with great facility, the phenomenological opportunism of the day. I remember it was 10 years ago. The analysis, touching on the quick of the problem, as rendered by a stylish young intellectual who put it this way. Once upon a time, he told the audience, it was worth the risk of dying for two reasons. The first was that heroism was rewarded in another world. The second was that heroism was rewarded in the memory of man who built the foundations of freedom upon the sacrifices of others. But now, he said, now that we know from the scientific evidence that there is, in fact, no other world, no future world, no transcendent heaven, and now that we have invented weapons that are capable of destroying all of mankind, and therefore all of human memory along with it, what is the reason left for heroism, for war, or even for the risk of war, he asked. One can see that the cutting edges of the argument nowadays, 10 years later, stressed, if you notice, not so much as they did then the nuclear war that would abolish mankind, as they do the derivable senselessness of any war at all, or the senselessness even of the threat of war. Indeed, derivatively, the senselessness of a convincing Army, Navy, and Air Force, tools of our tools. But why, they ask, in effect, what is the justifying point in an armed service in a nuclear age? It seems to me, finding oneself in such a polemical corner, that in days gone by, one had merely to reach into one's arsenal, as Patrick Henry did, and pull out the arrow that has freedom written on it, touch it down on the skeptic, and he would waste away like the witch, come in contact with water. You will have noticed it doesn't work anymore. Freedom is increasingly accepted as a condition describable only by subjective postulation. Professor Ross Terrell of Harvard, author of the two most influential articles that have appeared in our time on the subject of Red China, articles avidly read by the President of the United States and his staff who accompanied him to Peking 2 years ago, is to be distinguished from the famous apologists for Stalin's Russia, who made their way a generation ago by simply denying the crimes imputed to Stalin during the 30s and 40s. Terrell denies nothing. He doesn't disguise the condition of life in China today, not for a minute. After informing us that in China there is no freedom to practice religion, nor to vote, nor to express oneself freely, nor to read books or periodicals one desires to read, nor to join a labor union, nor to change one's job, nor to travel to another city or another country, he notes ingenuously, people ask me, is China free? He answers with great difficulty. Depends what you mean by freedom, he says. Freedom, he explains, is always defined with reference to the limitations of the relevant entity. And whereas the operative entity in the West happens to be the individual, in China it happens to be the whole state. And he illustrates. Consider the writer Kuo Mojo. In the 30s, he wrote books for a mere 4 or 5 or at most 8,000 people. Now he is required by the state to write books that will appeal to 20, 30, 50 million people. Is that wrong? The Harvard professor asks. Then he says there's the researcher at Peking University, whose affinity has been for abstract science, but who was recently directed to concentrate all of his time on pest control. Is that wrong? Terrell asks once again. And I think we begin to understand the phenomenon, the ideological egalitarianism that rushes in after practical diplomacy. Such that Richard Nixon, who went to China to establish a dialogue with Mao Zedong, ended by likening Mao's revolution to America's revolution, ended by proclaiming that we would have a long march together, as if to say that Mao, too, is entitled to his Via Dolorosa, where is Vatican III. Why should we not ecumenically share our own with him? And there is Mr. Nixon, seated in Peking next to Madame Mao Zedong, watching resignedly in the little chamber ballet become agitprop, a violation of art as well as of manners. It was as though We had invited the presidents of the Black African Republics to the White House there to show them a ballet on the theme of Little Black Sambo. And Mr. Nixon, returning to the United States, proclaiming at Andrew Air Force Base the great enthusiasm the Chinese people feel for their government. Indeed, the Chinese have done much to illustrate ways of generating enthusiasm for their government, and no doubt Mr. Nixon is professionally fascinated by them. You see, but we see through him the movement of Western opinion. What really is so bad about Red China? Their ways, not our ways, to be sure. But is it seriously proposed that we should be prepared to die if necessary in order to avoid living by their word rather than by our own, which is in any case corrupt, racist, decadent, and above all, materialist? The ongoing search for a new American revolution that would restore meaning to the individual is up against the two most conspicuous precedents of the century. Two great revolutions whose extirpative passion, however, proved to be the elimination of the individual. And indeed, we note that the revolutionary rhetoric of the day pays only formalistic attention to the individual, preferring to appeal to the people. Indeed, metaphysical defenses of man are somehow just a little embarrassing, irrelevant. Even Whitaker Chambers, the ardent counter-revolutionist, would make gentle scorn of the inflexible defenders of the individual. The late Mr. Frank Meyer, for instance, whose implacable scorn, a book which he called In Defense of Freedom, was current when the Republicans suffered their great congressional defeat of 1958. If the Republican Party does not find a way to appeal to the mass of the people, Chambers wrote me at that time, it will find itself voted into singularity. It will become then something like the little shop you see in the crowded parts of great cities in which no business is done or expected. You enter it and find an old man in the rear fingering for his own pleasure oddments of cloth, caring not at all if he sells any. As your eyes become accustomed to the gas light, you are only faintly surprised to discover that the old man is Frank Meyer. Submit to the critics of America, reduce the price of apples when they are abundant, increase the price of apples when they are scarce. Score one more thought for Chairman Mao. Now, granted, higher authority, that is the term they use in China, higher authority isn't always finely tuned to the vagaries of human nature, to such things as harvest yields and fluctuating human tastes and reallocations of still higher authority. And when the highest authority himself makes the wrong decisions, well, let's let Professor Tobin tell it, the traveling companion of Mr. Galbraith and economic advisor to the late George McGovern. Professor Tobin observes, Mr. Galbraith quotes, observes that there are no dogs or cats in China. The reason, he says, is presumably economic. If food has been scarce and rationed, affection for a participating pet must diminish. This seems especially probable, he concludes, if the pet is itself edible. Let me tell you something, Professor Galbraith and Professors Revel and Tobin and anyone else who wants to hear it. The reason for eating one's pet dog isn't economic. It is biological. It is the assertion of biological need over economic choice. And it is to such biological compulsions that the Chinese were recently driven by high authority. And when higher authority, assuming the mantle of the marketplace, makes miscalculations so serious that not even great politeness serves to bring dissidents into line, why then the muzzle of a gun becomes the only relevant article of the marketplace, and the supply of guns in China never fluctuates with the seasons. By that time, Mr. Galbraith has finished his brief passage in China and is back now in America, preaching the anachronism of the free marketplace and the price system, and dealing with his own dissenters, not always with great politeness. Perhaps Samuel Johnson went too far when he remarked 200 years ago that man is seldom so innocently engaged as when in pursuit of profit. But I confess to being more shaken by the complimentary suggestion that the free marketplace introduces mutual aggressiveness. Surely that, not Johnson's, is the climactic effrontery. But the notion that it is an act of aggression to lay before the individual a choice, whether of canned soups or of economic textbooks or of newspapers, by that token, it becomes an act of aggression to write another song or paint a canvas or set down a verse or write a judicial opinion on the grounds that by doing so we muscle into territory already spoken for. The ethical case against the